In this video, we will talk about some theoretical aspects of wind power generation. In particular, after this lecture, you will be able to explain the basic principles of wind power generation when the turbine is replaced by a thin disk. You will be able to quantify, based on the same theory, the maximum power produced. And you will also be able to explain one reason why a wind turbine with a large number of blades does not necessarily produce more power. Finally, you will be able to explain one reason why a turbine rotating faster does not necessarily produce more power neither. In order to understand the process of wind energy conversion, it is useful to represent the wind turbine rotor in a simple way, as a disk. So what happens to the flow in the presence of this disk? Well, if the disk is free to move with the wind, it does not exert any force on the flow, and therefore the wind is completely undisturbed. In this case, no energy is extracted from the wind. By contrast, if the disk is fixed, it tends to oppose the wind flow by exerting a force on it, and the flow is disturbed. In particular, the flow is slowed down by this force T, and at the same time, it tends to go around the disk. Energy can be extracted from the flow if both the force T and the velocity just behind the disk are non-zero. The latter implies that the disk should not block completely the flow. Instead, it should allow for some flow to go through the disk. In other words, the disk should be porous. We will see shortly that this has some consequences on the number of blades and also the rotational speed of the rotor. The power extracted from the wind at the disk equals the product of the force T and the velocity at the disk. This is why both quantities should be non-zero in order to extract power. Considering that the disk represents the wind turbine rotor, the velocity at the disk is denoted by UR. So to summarize, we have seen that if the disk does not exert any force on the flow, then the velocity at the disk, or the rotor, is maximum, but the power extracted is zero. By contrast, if the force exerted by the rotor is maximum, the velocity at the disk is brought to zero. Therefore, the power is also zero. Thus, even intuitively, there should be an optimum combination of force T and velocity at the rotor that maximizes the power. It can be shown that the power is maximum when the velocity at the disk is 2/3 of the incoming wind speed. This means that the rotor acts as a porous disk, exerted a constant force on the flow, but while still letting 2/3 of the flow through it. In this case, the non-dimensionalized force exerted by the rotor is 8/9. With these values, the power extracted by the rotor is 59% of the total power available in the wind at the location of the rotor. In other words, the non-dimensionalized power coefficient is 0.59. This is called the Betz limit. Without going through the details of the mathematical derivation, this limit is obtained by multiplying 2/3 of the velocity with 8/9 of the force. It gives a ratio of 16/27, which equals 0.59. Although this model represents a very simple approximation of a wind turbine rotor, it is an effective way of describing the global effect at the wind flow as on the rotor. Of course, more advanced models are needed to account for the fact that the wind turbines have more complex geometries than a simple disk. In particular, a wind turbine is composed of blades, usually 2 or 3, the hub and nacelle, which connect the blades and also encompass the generator, the tower, which supports the rotor nacelle assembly, and the foundation, mounted either on land or offshore. I've just mentioned that a wind turbine rotor is composed of usually two or three blades. But why don't we use more blades? 4, 5, 6, or even more? Well, as the number of blades increases, the force on the rotor also increases, but the velocity of the wind going through it decreases. So the higher the number of blades, the higher the blockage of the flow. In the limit of an infinite number of blades, the rotor would be a solid disk with no air going through. Similarly, there is a limit to the rotational speed of the rotor. For a given number of blades, for example 3, the higher the rotational speed, the higher the blockage of the flow. At very low rotational speed, the flow sees 3 blades spinning. But as the rotational speed increases, the flow sees effectively a rotor with more than 3 blades. Therefore, less wind will go through, resulting in less power. In conclusion, a wind turbine that rotates faster does not necessarily produce more power. This is why, for each wind speed, there is an optimum rotational speed that maximizes the power. We will come back to this in another video. But this also means that a wind turbine is designed to operate at a given tip speed ratio, that is the ratio between the rotational speed of the velocity at the tip of the blade and the incoming wind speed. This ratio is commonly denoted TSR. Note that the velocity of the tip of the blade is the product of the rotational speed of the rotor, here omega, and the length of the blade, r. As you can see from the formula, for a given wind speed, u, if the length of the blade r increases, omega has to decrease in order to keep the tip speed ratio constant. Thus, in theory, a rotor half as small will rotate twice as fast. To summarize, in this video, we explain the basic principles of wind power generation based on the thin disk. Based on the same theory, we saw that there is a theoretical limit to the power produced, the Betz limit. We learned that wind turbines with a large number of blades do not necessarily produce more power. And finally, we learned that large rotational speed do not necessarily yield more power neither. In the next video, we will see how the power extracted by the rotor varies with the wind speed and the rotational speed of the rotor.